You're back on NewDay. The newspapers are here. Quickly, look at them. The finder on the front page says, review £953.4 million deal. ASAP is telling government to do that. It comes with a photograph of the executive director of ASAP and asking that that agreement before Parliament be reviewed. We'll take a look at that. And then the General Telegraph says, Electoral Commission staff sacked for sending voters register verification machine to Baumia's house. The story on page 13. We'll take a deeper look at that too. And also, the Daily Statesman has on the front page NPP against EC's e-transmission of results. And Mr. McMahon's photograph is here, as well as that of the chairperson of the Electoral Commission. And the BNFT says airline safety tax deferred to October 1 as stakeholders ask for more time. We'll take a look at these and more when I tell who my guests are. This morning, to do the conversation, two men from Ghana's parliament. They are incumbent members of parliament. They're still asking for a renewal of their mandate from the Tema East constituency, Daniel Ni Kwatai Titus Glover. Grateful for your time this morning.
Good morning.
And how was your weekend?
My weekend was a bit tight because I had a lot of engagements with my constituents and all that. It's quite a tough one.
Okay. This job. And the campaigning is ongoing.
It's going very well.
Oh, great.
Except that my opponent is unwilling and going dirty.
Oh, I see.
And they've started tearing my banners.
You're sure your opponents did it?
Oh, they have arrested him.
Okay.
And referred to the police, yes.
They arrested your opponent?
No, I mean, one of the activists of the NDC.
All right.
But you said your opponent.
And he's already...
I'm coming there.
Okay.
You know, and on Saturday night, a friend to my opponent threatened one of my supporters. They went to the police station to lodge a complaint. This money will follow it up.
Okay, so this is a police story.
Yeah,
okay,
so
all right.
What is going on? They should put it.
Okay, all right. And from the NATO constituency is the Trade and Industry Deputy Minister and Honorable Ibrahim Mutala Mohammed.
He's honorable.
Good morning.
Good morning
and welcome. I hope you're doing great and your weekend was fine too.
Inshallah, I'm okay.
Okay. Are you coming from NATO this morning?
No, I was in my constituency last week. And like he said, we are very optimistic. I wouldn't sit here and use a platform to chastise my opponent when he would not have the opportunity to respond. I just know that I'm working, even though there are attempts to do mass, you know, transfers. I'm waiting
to see what happens.
If anybody tries 100, I will do 1,000.
Yeah,
I haven't said my opponent. You said they even arrested. You said they arrested.
Okay, all right. And then I have social commentator and an energy expert, Mr. Kunjo Poku, with us. Good morning.
Good morning.
And
how are you?
I hope your weekend was good too.
My weekend was
you
okay.
Have little to do with politics.
No, nothing at all. Very quiet. Very quiet weekend. I just admire the two of them making us excited this morning.
Actually, your colleague panelists are smiling. When I say you had very little to do with politics, they seem to be laughing. Why?
Well, we all have little to do with politics, me and you. Okay. They are in the constituency. They are in the constituency. They are in the constituency fighting it out. Some are accusing, some are in police. So we don't have that problem.
All right.
We just wait for 7th
December to come.
Go and use the
I'm grateful. Yes. Gentlemen, this is Election Command Center, and our pledge is to remain responsible and decorous in our conversation. Grateful for your time once again, and thanks so much. Let's start with this one. A quick look at that and then we can move on. A lot of stories from the Electoral Commission this morning. Now, first of all, the NPP is against EC's transmission of results electronically. Let me start with Mr. Titus Glover. Why is this a big issue?
Well, good morning once again to your viewers, especially from the east of Tema. It was this morning that I heard the story on one of the networks that my campaign manager is saying that they are not comfortable about the transmission electronically of the results. I'm here to get a full brief of exactly what he meant. But when I heard from the news, what he's saying is that the CN94 that is before the house now is not telling us as to the electronic transmission of the results.
Right.
And because there has been some bad precedents, in Mexico and few other countries. He's not comfortable that the use of electronic transfer will service any good purpose. Why can't we use the authentic results, the big sheets,
right,
and the final results that is signed at the collation center, which each party is given a copy, you know, of these results, then we can have the opportunity to use that. But as to what really went into the information, I'm here to get a full brief of what exactly is all about. But we need to be careful. A lot of things happened in the 2012 elections, and for that matter, we need to safeguard things that we do that would not serve a better purpose for all of us. So I think that we all need to support the Electoral Commission. The IPAC is a very powerful platform where all stakeholders can go and make their case. I hear they wanted to make a formal complaint to the Electoral Commission to really state their position so clearly on this subject matter, so that we all together see how whether it is feasible or not. I know the Electoral Commission is going to put up boards, you know, collation centers. So all the results that will be coming, they will have the opportunity to record it on these boards and all that, so that everybody will follow whatever results that is coming from the collation centers and all that. So for me, I just want to hold my fire for now.
Okay.
Get a full brief of exactly what the position
is. The position.
So that we can be able to make a very strong argument for all that.
Okay.
In short, all I is saying is that it is not the best. Okay. Looking at what has happened in Mexico and a few other places, would have the recipe to create a lot of problems here and there.
All right. Let me go to Honorable Ibrahim Murtala Mohammed, Comrade Ibrahim Murtala Mohammed. Now, Mr. McMenu's concerns are that, one, the NPP is asking that the declaration is made only with the use of the pink sheets. Now, so he's asking if indeed the EC has said that it will use the pink sheets to declare who is the president of Ghana, what is the need for the e-transmission of results? That is Mr. McMenu's worry.
Well, let me say good morning to your cherished listeners and also use this opportunity to extend my sincerest condolences to the family of Alhaji Amadou, the global holiday man.
Global.
I say this because his kids are my very good friends, and it's unfortunate that such a fine gentleman, who indeed assisted a lot of people, permeating, you know, all the political parties in this country, and someone who has contributed significantly towards the growth of the economy of this country, unfortunately we had to lose him. We can only say may Allah shower his blessings, may he find favor in the merciful hands of Allah. Let me also use it as an opportunity to extend my greetings to my constituency. I mean, it's important. My good friend said he was in the constituency. I was telling my friend that it's possible he didn't go to the constituency, but once he sits here, he would want his constituency to know how lovely he is. I think that we need to be very mindful about the sanctity of the Electoral Commission. And I have said time and again that the continuous, you know, accusatory rhetorics against the Electoral Commission reduces the value, reduces the standing it has in the eyes of the Ghanaian people. It doesn't matter who the Electoral Commission is. It doesn't matter what the institution is. What is important is that they conduct elections to the satisfaction of everybody. Nothing happened in 2012. Nothing untoward happened. What happened in 2012 was that the NDC won, and then MPP arrogantly refused to admit NDC won, went to court, and lost the case. So nothing happened. We all need to also understand that we have never had any elections where the pink sheets from polling stations were sent directly either to coalition centers, onward sent physically to the EC, if you like, strong room before elections.
So that's the case.
We have never had that. I mean, every year you'd have the polling, the pink sheet sent to the coalition centers, and then they fax them.
Right.
So whether electronic, whether faxing, whether post, the NDC would win. There's no question at all about that. You don't win elections at the coalition centers. You don't win elections at the EC headquarters. Neither do you win elections at the Supreme Court. You win elections at the polling stations. And whereas certain political parties are organizing on the ground, some people are on radio, some people are thinking that once again, they would go to court. That is not why you win elections. So I find it extremely difficult to fathom why such a suggestion would resurface again, when we have never had that. So are they now suggesting that all the polling stations, the pin sheets at the polling stations, be sent to the coalition centers and physically sent to the electoral commission's headquarters?
It's absolutely impractical. The EC chairperson, who's the returning officer for the presidential elections, should declare the results using only the pin sheets.
And then they then do what with that result? They would then have to send that result to the EC headquarters. How would they send it? Physically, with the pin sheets?
If the pin sheets will be sent to via fax or whatever to the EC's office, is there indeed the need for e-transmission of the results?
No, I'm just saying that we have never had suggesting. I'm saying that in every elections, all the pin sheets at the polling stations, when the political party representative signs, the elector officer signs, they would then send the pin sheets, those sheets, to the coalition centers.
Right.
Then they would then collate the results of all the various polling stations and then wire that information to the Electoral Commission. Now, I get the sense.
Right.
The suggestion is that, no, once you send the pink sheets to the polling centers, because elections results are not declared, you know, for the entire national elections at the coalition centers. They are declared by the Electoral Commission.
That's and the presidential.
The presidential.
The presidential.
They are declared
because
by,
she is a return officer.
That's something. They are declared by the Electoral Commission. Mm. That's what we are. I don't think that we're just looking at.
Parliamentary.
The results are declared there. Now, are they suggesting that when we send the pink sheets to the polling centers and the results are collated there, parliamentary, you know, MPs are declared, or parliamentary elections results are declared, they should physically send the same pink sheets? If not, what we have been doing, they fax. So what's the difference? It simply doesn't make sense to me. Except that probably, like my good friend said, they need to come clearer. Because I simply can't get it. Between sending something through fax and electronic, fax is electronic. The last time I checked, fax itself is electronic. So what kind of electronic are they suggesting? Except they are saying that, no, when you send the pink sheets to the coalition centers, after the results are collated at the coalition centers, we would want you to send the same pink sheets to the Electoral Commission. And I believe that can take us more than a month. I can tell you.
I see.
It can take us more than a month for us to be able to do it. And then we would have indeed be even violating the constitutional provision when the president should be sworn in. I think that we need to understand that you can only win elections at the polling centers. Galvanize your forces. Do your work very well. Mobilize your people to come out and vote. Sell to the people of this country what you have. Tell them what you are able to do or what you'll be able to do. Because the NDC goes to the elections, telling the people of this country what we have done, and also admitting that, yes, there are challenges. Despite those challenges, these are the strides that we have indeed have been able, with the support of the Ghanaian people, to achieve. And we are very optimistic that the signals are very positive. I think that this is the kind of message that we should be sending to the people of this country. But on a more serious note, we all need to protect the integrity of the Electoral Commission. And that's what I mean. As a young person engaged in this business of politics, even when we're in opposition, I never raise a finger against the Electoral Commission. Because that the sanctity of that office ought to be protected. The Electoral Commission serves as an arbiter between all and among political
parties.
Even if
they are doing something that you think is wrong?
There should be evidence. That is why I premise my statement by saying that the accusatory rhetorics that are coming out from responsible political leadership in this country is not something that helps. One, it derails the efforts of the Electoral Commission. It devalues the Electoral Commission. People begin to look at the Electoral Commission in a spectacles that they ought not look at it. And when it reaches a time that a lot more Ghanaians lose confidence in the Electoral Commission, then you can only pave way for chaotic and anarchy. And I think that is one thing all of us must ensure that we protect. Okay. We need to protect it. Okay. You may not be comfortable with members of the Electoral Commission. You may not be. But as long as they do what is supposed to be done, and I agree with my friend, that APAC need to do a lot, that there should be consistency and, you know, collaborations and discussions. There is nothing wrong with expressing one's opinion on an issue. There is nothing wrong with any political party raising questions about certain things, the things that are not done. But you can't have it all your way. And in fact, the electoral process is political parties ought to be building consensus. And when you are building consensus, you lose some and you gain some. Mm. The NDC, NPP must all at any point in time make some compromises to ensure that all the political parties and the good people of this country will have a semblance of fair elections such that no one would have any problem. I really don't think that we want to go through what we went through in the aftermath of the 2012
election. All right, I'm grateful. Mr. Kojupuku, let's look at this. Now, this story is... seem to suggest that Mr. McMahon is talking about two modes of transmissions. There's an electronic transmission and there's one from the pink sheet. Now, one of the main demands from the 2012 election petition was that the returning officer for the presidential election should only announce the results after receiving the pink sheet, and which the EC says is the right thing. So Mr. McMahon is asking, if that is the case, what is the e-transmission for? Because we're told that EC has about five companies already bidding for that job. Is Mr. Menu worried about something that we should be worried about too?
Well, you can see that there isn't a lot of explanation, and that is my problem with the EC.
Right.
I think when EC means well, I don't think the EC means harm to anybody. But the problem they have is how they communicate their program and the agenda to the citizenry and the political parties. You can see that there's difference of opinion in what is being said. Mr. McMahon is worried about something, which rightfully so. You know, this is Ghana where we hardly get things right, okay? And doing things electronically has its pros and cons. What I suggest is that in any time that EC has a program for the political parties and for the election 2012, it should be explained in detail, so that every single person knows exactly, because you can remember, you see that my brother is saying, and he's not 100% sure, and he's a deputy minister, parliamentarian, titles, whatever, the parliamentarian, he's not 100% sure of what's happening. It means that the EC...
About the coalition.
No, I mean the e-transmission,
no,
what
no,
it entails.
We are absolutely sure.
That there are five companies bidding for...
I'm coming, no, that was not the question. We are absolutely sure how results are transmitted.
No, we know what, that, but no, I'm saying this particular...
No, we are just unsure about the position of the NPP.
No. What I'm saying is that this e-transmission, what exactly...
Mr. Menno is worried about.
No, we understand that. We understand that. You see, at a point, we all watched the Supreme Court case. So sort of every Ghanaian who watched it, it's sort of an expert in lecture. What happens is that the coalition centers gets all the pink sheets from the constituencies.
Right.
And the coalition officer now collates all the polling stations and declare a number for the presidential candidate in every
polling station.
Mm. So that constituency, the presidential candidate will have a number.
Right.
That number is now transmitted to the return officer, who is the EC chairman, for the presidential election.
Elections, right.
Now, that mode of transmission, what is transmitted is not the pink sheet. It is the coalition sheet.
I see.
The coalition sheet that is transmitted. You understand? So no, the pink sheet,
not the pink sheet.
No, the pink sheet, from what we are told, is what the officers, police, the polling station officers get. Everybody signs.
Yeah.
Then they all go to the coalition center. Then the coalition officer tallies everything onto a coalition sheet. And he declares the parliamentary.
Yeah.
Okay.
Not the presidential.
Not the presidential. But on that coalition sheet, there is a number for each presidential candidate, which needs to be tallied by the EC chairman, who is a returning officer for the presidential. So that coalition sheet is sent. Now, how that is sent is what I think they are talking about. The e-transmission, whether because in the past it's been done by fax.
Okay, in the past it was done,
it's
by,
done
fax.
By fax.
And now, Mr. McMahon is talking about some e-transmission. So it means that there are two different
things. No. The e-transmission
is the same thing.
Is the same thing. How do you transmit? You see, what basically they are trying to, what they are trying to establish is that how do we get information from the various constituencies to the EC chairman? Okay, the only resource announced by the EC chairman is the presidential. So I don't think, like my brother said, we are talking about the parliamentary.
No, I haven't suggested
I understand that. So we are talking about presidential.
No, you see, can I just...
Come in quickly. I've been tight.
You see, all the political parties have representation at the Electoral Commission stronghold.
Mm-hmm.
So any results that is sent, all the political parties will be aware. In Nanton constituency, let's say a polling station like Bualeni, I'm just giving an example. This was what I got. This was what NDC got. So it is not something that is sent to only electoral commission, mm-hmm. and the political parties are not aware. And in fact, all the political parties also have their coalition where they sit, and branches and constituencies send results. Mm-hmm. When the EC, the results that is sent to the electoral commission, mm-hmm. if the NDC or the MPP feels that, look, this doesn't reflect what we have
at the other end.
At the
other
remember, Kovna Japon yes. and Co. tried the, to do
were,
something.
There were yes. issues
you see,
like that.
And they had problems with Tornado and Co. I'm saying that if you have a problem with it, then you challenge it. Mm-hmm. So it is not something that is done in secrecy.
Yes.
The, this thing is suggesting that the pink sheet, that's what
be they... faxed. Be,
no, I...
Or be physically...
No, that's what I'm saying. The that story, is a story that is not carried
exactly,
right.
Exactly,
that is why... The story is not carried right. Because okay. pink sheets are not transmitted, and everybody knows that.
No, right. Maybe the suggestion is that when the results are collated, I'm just guessing.
They should each transmit
they
all
the
pink sheets.
They should send the pink sheets.
No.
And that's okay. why I raised the question that
okay.
that is the
all
case.
Right.
It's not possible.
It's not possible, yes.
That's all right. Possible. So you come in, Titus come in before we deal with this
I
one.
I want to read a quote from Mr. Magmenu here.
Mm.
Okay.
And it says that Mr. Magmenu does not see e-transmission as addressing the critical challenges that the reform process seeks to do. For example, he notes, resource transmission does not in any way control the abuse of the electoral process. It does not address foreign ballots. Is it an after-the-fact process? If there are only 800 voters on the register, how would the system prevent transmission of results cast in excess of that number? Finally, to the MPP, the e-transmission can end up creating confusion where there is discrepancy between the electronically transmitted results and what is contained on the actual pink sheet. And I think that this is what he's trying to address. The e-transmission, in a way, makes the process faster in transmission of results.
Great.
But should there be any discrepancy on the ground, how are you going to rectify that? And I think that is where his difficulty and challenge is all about. And like I'm saying, we need to sit down as an IPAC to see how do we address that. If the e-transmission is the best, how are you going to deal with the discrepancy as and when it comes before you transmit it? If the correction is done and we can be able to transmit it and copies are made available to all political parties, I don't have a problem. Look, let me tell you, Mutapa,
Mutala. My name is Mutala.
Mutala, don't tickle yourself and laugh. I can tell you. You can make all the goodies and all your things that you're doing. I'm telling you, this election, nobody says that elections are won at the EC headquarters.
That's how your party believes in.
Is that what thing?
They are won at the Supreme
because
Court.
Because the Supreme
that's
Court
what, on the streets.
Oh, please.
Come here, please allow
me.
Okay.
You've talked plenty, so please. We all know they are won at the polling station. That is where the Supreme Court is now.
Mm.
So that we make sure that we police every ballot that comes. So nobody is going to take chances at all. Agents that we are sending to the polling station are going to be agents who are going to do what is right to the people in.
And that's very simple. Just
you understand?
Making sure the figures are inputted.
It's
not a battle.
The way this country is running.
Mm.
Your performance is there for all Ghanaians to see.
How?
That you are building
you. Schools, building
okay.
hospitals,
every government
roads.
Builds schools.
How many?
Well, every government builds
schools. You didn't build a single secondary school.
Provides water.
8 years.
Comrade, can you allow him?
He's a white elephant.
You allow Ghanaians to make that decision.
Yes.
Titus, you go on.
It's a waste of resource.
Oh, I see.
Go on.
You could have used that to expand the old schools.
Wow.
You understand? So don't think that Ghanaians are happy of what you are doing. You have the money. You have all resources, you have the security, but we have the people. And I can tell you, I'm telling you.
We are more represented.
Your mama and the NDC
you
have to lose this election.
Titus, can you stay focused on this? Let's wrap up on this one.
What I'm saying is that Mr. Peter Magmenu has made his point.
Mm.
And I'm sure there is a platform that deals with electoral matters.
Mm.
That is the IPAC. How are we going to address these things? These are his challenges, these are his difficulty. A typical example where for about 2 weeks, in the transmission of resources, he said it's Ecuador. There was a holdup. You can imagine the tension that will be happening in the country at that time. So if we are using electronic transfer and for days results are not tricking in, what is going to happen? Let us sit down and look at the wisdom of what Mr. Magmenu is saying. You may disagree with him.
Mm.
You understand? But when we all sit down as stakeholders to look at the issues that he has brought up
and whether it is proper and feasible, why not? We will buy into it. If we think that we cannot, we will go back again and look at the whole matter and deal with it.
They took my time a little bit. Can I come back? Something that I would want to suggest is this. You see, when election is done, in the night, midnight, 1 a.m., 2 p.m., everybody is so much in a hurry looking for results and all that. Can I suggest something? And since I have two big parliamentarians with me, why don't we have a system whereby on the day of election, everybody concentrates on the polling station's work? Then after pink sheets have been signed and everybody is happy with the counting and the ballot box are sealed, everybody goes home. And collation is done the following morning. That is something I think we should take into as a nation. That it is because that when election is done on the election day, we call it, we count. No, we count at the, you see, after counting at the polling stations and the boxes are sealed and pink sheets are signed and everybody takes their copy. Going to that collation center at 2 a.m. and 3 a.m. and waiting for the...
No.
Who are you waiting for? What I'm saying is that... Titus, what will happen during the night? What will happen at night?
We should all keep the vigil and count it.
No, but we've counted. We finished counting.
We are even going to police the special voting. I'm telling you. The special voting that is
happening
in the police armory.
Can I make?
We are going to police it very well.
Okay, it's
that is what we are here. They want to do magic.
No, there's no magic. Chato, please don't make allegations.
Can I make this?
Okay.
I never knew that the polling agents MPP sent to polling stations in 2012 were absolutely ramshackle. They were moribunds. He is making that statement on this platform that they are going to send
competent. He only sent this time. They are sending.
Yeah, he said that they are going to. Yes, it means that those they send were not competent, clearly. And two, what is he talking about? What is Mr. McMinu talking about? All the political parties before the elections, the voter register is made available to every single political party. So every single political party will be well aware how many people have registered in every single polling station. So at the end of the day, when results are declared, parliamentary results are declared at the polling stations, then collation is done at the collation center. Then parliamentary elections are declared. Of course, like he said, what every presidential candidate gets would have been declared there, would have been made known.
Right.
This constituency, this is what
the presidential,
this is what political party A got, this is what political party B got. Now, if they transmit that electronically or by air or by wind or by sea or whatever, and it doesn't reflect what all the political parties have as the number of people registered to vote in any polling station, you have the opportunity. And I'm saying that they attempted that. They, who are now appointing
in the case of
2008, they attempted that.
Even in 2012, Dr. Farajan was asked to hold on.
Yes,
with the
I'm saying that. If they send the results and you know that in his constituency, Tema East, a particular polling station, no, the total voter register per, the register that is given to all the political parties is 500. We have 600 voting for MPP and we have 400 voting for NDC. NDC can raise concerns. NDC can say, look, it doesn't reflect what we have there. And I'm saying that it's simple. So I simply can't get it. And he himself admitted that probably he needs to get more briefing. We need to be more informed. What is it? My understanding, and let me admit, that's a guesswork. My understanding about what is being said there is about the fact that, no, send pink sheets, not only to the coalition centers, but to EC. It simply doesn't change anything.
How are they going to do that?
Well, that is the point.
How are they going to do that?
That is the point.
Okay, and we'll get more information on that.
We need to get more information on that. That would be difficult to do.
Right. I'm grateful for that. Now, let's move on to this story that's also making interest before we deal with the energy one. Now, it is about this Munti FM 3, a lot of petitions here and there. And the Daily Guide has this story that says that Tony Lathe against pardon for Munti 3 as pressure mount on President John Mahama, and another paper also carried that same story. Okay, the General Telegraph. Daniel, let me quickly look at this one. Yes, the Daily Statesman
It's also talking about the nominee, Deputy Minister Oti Blessing, in more trouble over Munti attacks on Chief Justice. And then also, Occupy Ghana to Mahama and says, rebuke upon T signing Munti 3 petition. So the news is that a lot of pressure being brought to bear on the presidency to use his powers to reduce the sentence on these persons. This morning, we're told of a float in town that is expected to say thank you to the Supreme Court of Ghana for that verdict. But we're told that a lot of pressure is being brought to bear on the presidency. Comrade Ibrahim Murtala Mohammed, is indeed the president getting that pressure?
Well, the president can never be... No, I don't think there can be any pressure exerted on the president to do what he doesn't deem fit. And I also don't think that there can be any pressure exerted on the president not to do what he deems fit.
Mm.
But let's get something very clearly. The Constitution guarantees and determines the conduct of every single person in this country, including the Supreme Court justices. Article 58 talks about the executives and what they can do and what they cannot do.
Mm.
Article 93 talks about the legislature, which myself and my friend are all members, what we can do and what we cannot do. Of course, there are certain, if you like, protection that is given to members of parliament, certain things that we can say freely on the floor and no court would take us on, except things that violate on the constitution. Mm. And those things the court can determine. But our decisions, our discussions, our deliberations and debates are anchored and guided one by the constitution and, most importantly, the standing orders of parliament.
Right.
And that is why we have some immunities, more or less, that certain things you can say in parliament and no court would, because in an attempt to do that, there will be what they call the infringing on the principle of separation of powers. Of course, Article 125 talks about the conduct, the authority that the judiciary has. We have theories of separation of powers. Montesquieu's view is that there should be absolute and distinct, if you like, separation of powers, where the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary are completely distinct and there can be interference. But Ghana, we are implementing what they call the John Locke's theory.
Right.
That yes, you can have separation of powers, you can have them distinct, but there's something he introduced as checks and balances. And those checks will check the conduct. The executive can do something, mm-hmm. and there are a lot of, you know, cases in Ghana that determines where the executive, I mean, even in America, you have what you call the Marbury and Madison, you have in Ghana, Riakoto, a lot of cases. You have J.H. Mensah and the Attorney General, a lot of cases. The NDC, MPP, and the IGP, you have a lot of cases in Ghana that determines the conduct of the executive in one way or the legislature, such that you cannot exercise powers beyond.
So your point is that there are checks and balances.
Yes, you cannot.
Great.
You cannot.
Mm.
Let us also understand that there is nowhere in the Constitution that says that the judiciary cannot be criticized. And let's get that very clearly. The judiciary can. There is no way in saying that decisions of the judiciary cannot be questioned. Decisions of the Supreme Court can be questioned, can be challenged. And that is why there is always a review. Mm-hmm. That if the Supreme Court indeed gives a ruling on a matter, you can go for a review.
Right.
Now, if you look at this case, I have listened to most interesting, you know, comments that are made by people who ought to know. And I have listened to some of those comments. And unfortunately, the fact that those comments are made, you know, exposed a section of the Ghanaian populace to the most outlandish and sometimes uninformed media work. I listened to a radio station on my way. Now, the Supreme Court indeed has sentenced some people on contempt, and I am not, and I would not have the capacity to question the decision of the Supreme Court. I can't, I won't question that. And I don't think that those who are signing that petition are saying that the Supreme Court did wrong. They are simply saying that that decision by the Supreme Court was harsh. That's right. What they are saying. Now, I have listened to...
And they have a right to. That's
yes, they have the right. I have listened to comments. Some have even said that the foundation and the foundation of our democracy was under attack. The Supreme Court has taken a decision. What the people are doing...
Is that not their view?
I'm coming. What the people are doing, the petition they are signing, those petitions are also not against the Constitution. The Constitution gives them that opportunity to do so. And the Constitution also says that you can petition the president. Per Article 72, the president can give amnesty, can give pardon. Even hardened criminals, the president in his wisdom can either give pardon or can even reduce the sentences or commit. If someone is sent to, let's say, 100 years or let's say to death, the president in activating the Article 72 can go ahead and do that. So let's get something very clear. Just as it is within the constitutional right of people to say that, yes, we are happy that, yes, once again, people attacked the judiciary and decisions were taken. The people who are also signing the petition are not on street. They are not destroying anything. They are not attacking anybody. I have listened to another most outlandish comment made by a journalist on Joy FM this morning. That why? Nana Oyelita, I don't know whether Nana Oyelita has signed that petition. They said
well,
that
we have a photograph.
Please, there is a photograph of the president. There is a photograph of the president signing, which is absolutely a concoction of the MPP. And check on their platforms. The president never signed any petition.
No, but
I'm coming. The picture. Oh, I'm saying that the picture, the same picture. I'm saying that they showed the same picture of the president signing. I am sitting here. I'm saying that even
you're
if.
You're saying that she hasn't signed?
I don't know.
Oh, okay,
but I'm
picture.
Saying that even if Nana Oyelita signs,
yes.
There is absolutely nothing wrong with that. There is nothing wrong with that.
Okay.
The decision of the judiciary, and I think that. I'm not saying that the judiciary ought not do what they did. They have the right constitutionally, you know, to commit anybody to contempt who undermined the integrity of the jury, particularly when there is a pending cases, okay? But I'm saying that it is within the constitutional and the democratic right of anybody, whether a minister or not a minister, to sign that. And let us not begin questioning the exercise of people's democratic right. And they think that we want to petition either the president or even the chief justice on ABCD if we want to do that. And then that has become so sacrilegious, that has become so bad, then people are even saying that the president should have problems with if you have ministers who have signed to that. I think that we need, look, okay. Let us look at the constitution is like a double-edged sword.
You can't take that okay.
Anyway.
Okay. No, he has 1 minute to wrap up.
So my conclusion is just that. Yes, in as much as we respect the decision of the Supreme Court, when the Supreme Court ruled when the Supreme Court ruled in the elections, Nanado said, yes, I disagree, but I have to respect it.
Okay.
So people can also say, I disagree with the decision of the Supreme Court, but you have no reason than to respect that decision. Okay. However, there are other constitutional provisions that gives you the opportunity. If you want to petition the president so that the president can pardon those people, you can't do that.
Okay.
If you want to petition
right.
even the chief justice, you can't do that.
All right.
That has become so.
Comrade, I'm grateful.
No,
I'm grateful. Mr. Kujibu, so Comrade Ibrahim Murtala Mohammed is talking about tolerance for divergence.
I believe that the country we are moving too much to the left. I think
where
punishment.
Left means where?
Punishment. We are becoming too liberal.
Okay.
Punishment as a deterrent is very important. And what this punishment does, the 3 months given to the four months given to
30,000.
Yes. I think it should have been more. You see, I think the punishment, the essence of the punishment is at a deterrent, to deter people. Okay? I am somebody that believe in when you do the crime, you should do the punishment. And the punishment should be as that it deters people from doing the wrong thing again.
Mm.
I don't think from today, if anybody goes to any radio station and starts muffing off in a way, the directors, the producers, and the people in the radio station will allow them to do that. Why? Because of what has just happened. There's nothing wrong with the level of the punishment, and there's nothing wrong as a deterrent to me. I think that they should have gotten more. But 4 months, it's okay. Let them serve their time. When they came back, they will have repented. Back.
No,
okay.
What I'm saying is that
it's serving as a deterrent. We are spreading the rod in this country and spoiling the children in this country. I think that these people deserve what they got. My problem with people signing this petition is this. If you are a cabinet minister, okay, I don't think you should sign that petition.
What do you mean by that?
If you're a cabinet,
my opinion
is that if you're a cabinet minister, because you see, the position of a cabinet minister is not like an ordinary citizen. A cabinet minister does not disagree with the president. That is why they're in cabinet. They go to cabinet and they take a decision. If you want to take a decision outside the cabinet and in the view that it does not go with the cabinet, you resign. I'm not saying
the
cabinet.
But the president has not taken a decision.
I know
yet.
That, but my point is that when you have cabinet ministers signing that petition, okay, it's a different thing altogether. To
how
me,
how different is
because
it?
Because they are in a certain position whereby they go into cabinet with the president. And if you are talking about pressure on the president to disagree with his contemporaries, reason being that, look, there are three, as you rightfully said, there are three arms of government. Mm. The CJ heads the judiciary, the speaker heads the parliament, and the president heads the executive. So the three, CJ, speaker, and the executives, are the three leaders of our arms of government. Mm. The CJ was attacked on this thing. So if you want the president to pardon these people, the president in his conscience must agree to what they did. You can't pardon somebody or sign a petition if you don't agree to what they did. To pardon someone, the person, you see, we have not even had the opportunity for them to serve the time. Let them do 1 month or 2 months, and then let's
but that decision is for the president.
Well, my point, why are we putting the man in that position?
Okay. What position?
What I'm saying is that for his cabinet ministers to also do that, I am thinking from advanced democracy in the UK, when cabinet ministers come out to say things and it's in contrary to what they want, because you see,
it's
I believe
it's not true.
Can you please address me so that
Brexit
you don't
find cabinet?
I've not asked you to talk.
No, but it's not even true. In this Brexit elections, you had cabinet ministers.
In the Brexit that he talks about, most people that did not agree with David Cameron resigned.
Who resigned?
He himself has resigned.
No, he himself has resigned.
What I'm saying, okay, let me please make my point. My point is this.
Please allow him.
I personally think that cabinet ministers should not sign that.
That's your opinion.
That's my opinion. Mm. Secondly, I think that they are putting undue pressure on the president, and it's not necessary because they want to put him on collision course with his contemporaries, the leaders of the arms of
parliament and the judiciary.
Because if the president comes on in attack, and they made that in Supreme Court alone, even the Attorney General should have picked up on the things that the people said, because there was a level of criminality involved, and they didn't. That is why they deemed it to bring on upon themselves to do what they did.
Mr. Poku, let me ask you before you wrap up, Mr. Titus Clover. You don't think that tolerance is interesting and exciting here? Mr. Tony Lither is against the president pardoning these persons. His wife is going to sign the petition. This is simply tolerance.
Well, who signed the petition? Likewise, what I'm saying is that there is level of critique. You can criticize, like my brother said, you can criticize. We all, the space of democracy needs critique.
Right.
A good leader is one that knows the people who criticize him, because then you hear it and take it on board. Mm. If CJ and the Supreme Court does not listen to criticism, then it wouldn't be evolving and being a better system. They do listen to criticism, but not threats. What these people did was threats. And threats are not condoned in any form, shape, or form. Right. So if they threatened and they are sentenced to 3 months, and you assign a petition. They threatened and they were fined contempt. Mm. My point is that if you are signed to 3 months and you are petitioning, are you condoning what they did? That's why you are petitioning, or you are not condoning?
That's the question. It's wrong for them to say that, 4 months is too much. So you said they think they should have had more. So if they reduce the 4 months and it
will not be a determined, because anybody else can do it, knowing very well that if I do it, I'll be pardoned.
I'm grateful.
I think
he was found guilty.
Titus is on the floor now.
I'm sure
Comrade will not distract
him.
I've warned him before he start. Okay, all right. Let's hear from you.
Because you could see how comfortable I was sitting and listening to him.
Great.
For him to pour all his inventives and attacks on us. But please, you see, let us call a spade and not a big spoon. You have a political party called NDC, whose genealogy and DNA can be traced to a killing of three high court judges.
No, Titus.
I'm saying
no,
the genealogy.
No,
the
history. Can we stay focused?
Let me speak.
I mean, if you say
what,
that.
What is the history of NDC? Where did they come from?
No, it is unfair.
Where did they come from?
Where your party come from?
Where did they come from?
You need to read the political history of Ghana.
Please.
And I can understand your
emotions.
punching and doing things.
See, you need to move on.
So move on. Comrade, all right, Titus, please.
Do you know how the MP...
Please, no. Comrade, I'll start your microphone.
You see, first place, the BNI has disappointed us. And you know why? They said they don't have the capacity to carry out their threats.
That's the BNI.
Two, the AG. Because the Supreme Court cannot defend themselves publicly. The institutions of state that are supposed to carry these things. But because they failed. And the day when the threat was issued was the day when those three high court judges were being killed.
The day before.
What signal is he sending? What are they remembering? And you think that somebody issues threats? We should just leave it just like that. Have you taken the chance to listen to Munti FM before?
Oman FM, I listen to.
Oman FM, they criticize the NDC.
If you stay focused, you see, make a lot of inroads. The Supreme Court went ahead and punished them. That is where we want to put our conversation.
Why you do that? You truncate my thoughts.
Okay, please.
I'm developing my argument.
I'm sorry, please go ahead.
It has moved from me to you.
When you listen, did you listen to what Arizako said? On this Munti thing?
No, I haven't had the opportunity.
Yes, you don't hear it.
They give him water.
I had an opportunity to call one senior member of government.
Who?
I will not mention
this. Didn't call anyone.
I will tell him privately.
No,
comrade.
Tell us. You didn't call anyone.
I called the chief of staff.
Comrade,
go and ask. I called the chief of staff.
That is what I want to hear.
I called Honorable Julius Debra. Ask him.
That's what I want to hear.
That the angle this Munti FM is going, and that day, the topic was Akufo-Addo. Insults. I said, if the way they are going. We also start attacking the president. I don't think that is going to be for us. Okay. He should call those people to order. Because that is not the level of politics we wanted to do. Wow. There's a saying in Ghana, you want to push the neck of an elephant. And that is the justice of the Supreme Court.
What is your point, Titus?
My point, my brother, is that what the gentleman did was bad. And I'm expecting Muntala here. The way he's talking and ducking and talking, should condemn the act.
I'm expecting him and his colleagues. But did I support
and
that?
Those ministers, you are supporting.
Wow.
Because you see, the way it's an affirmation that what the Munti guys were doing, they are comfortable with it.
How?
Exactly so.
No. Are you suggesting now that you are those signing the petition are comfortable?
Is that what you're saying?
That is their prerogative. That they can do whatever they want to do. They can do. I don't challenge them. That is why Ton Lita, who is the president's lawyer, he's against the acting.
But his wife
and I see his action are very noble.
His wife has signed it.
He's a minister of state.
And I think that is the beauty
He's a minister of state. They don't have to follow the bagwagon. They have to follow it.
Which is the bagwagon?
What you mean?
Because people have done wrong. When they were doing all these things, nobody could call this gentleman to order.
Oh, I see.
Nobody. They were happy. They were insulting, doing everything. Today, when they are caught in the law, we are saying that they should be pardoned. Of course, they are Ghanaians. What about those online Ghanaians who go and steal goats and cows and the chicken all over the place? Did you go? Did you go and say that they should be pardoned?
Which people?
Mutala.
Which people?
Those in your constituency, those who are found to be stealing ordinary yam.
No, they don't steal yam.
You understand?
They don't steal yam.
People who will steal.
I don't have criminals in my constituency.
Do you go and tell them they should be
pardoned? If they steal fish in your
constituency, tell us. You don't do that.
They do not steal yam, I beg you.
Seriously, I'm really, really, really disappointed.
In who?
In the way these NDC guys are going all over the place. You are putting on necessary. Me, I want the president to sign.
You don't think it is your opinion?
It's a bad opinion.
And that the president can decide to
accept or reject. It's a bad opinion.
Okay, all right.
It's a bad opinion. Because you are putting the man in the situation we find himself very difficult. Because he's going to parade his advisors to advise him.
To do what?
And that's the cabinet people.
You understand?
It's not cabinet.
So he has his advisors.
Yes.
So if the president is going to succumb to all these things, that he should go according to article, I've forgotten that.
72.
That he has a right to pardon, which we don't challenge. He can go ahead and pardon them. It means that he's affirming the behavior and the misconduct of these people.
Interesting.
To go wild everywhere.
Assuming he
threatened to do anything, assuming he
reduces the 4 months to two,
does that also
if he does anything about it,
to say that he supports it.
No, let me deal with the subject.
What do you mean by that?
That's your view.
That is the view of our society.
Titus, you go. No, it's
your society.
It's your society.
That's not my view.
Are you telling me that if a kid does something wrong in a house,
we ran out of time.
You know what? If His Excellency the President listens to this advice, and I tell you that advice would be a very bad advice, it is a felony that Muntie guy should be given the license more because he has the backing of the President and his government. And remember, this Mugabe guy, you know what, he's trying to put some tribal sentiment to the whole thing. Can I have the floor? He guys tried to bring some tribal angle. It's because he's a Nodna that he's been hauled to the Supreme Court. And there are so many NDC big shots that have been to prison, and for that matter, he doesn't fear to go to prison. Is it because he's a Nod? It is because there are a lot of Nodners who are law-abiding people. There are a lot of Nodners who will not misbehave and misconduct themselves the way he did. So if you have been caught by the law and you have been dealt with, please keep quiet and allow the law to take its course. Why? Don't you have Nodners in the Supreme Court? Don't you have members of the Supreme Court who are from the North? So if they want to play the tribal angle, wouldn't they recuse themselves from the case? Mutala, just keep quiet.
Oh, he's not smoking.
He wants to interject.
How do you?
I see.
Everyone's gestures. So what I'm going to say is that Muntie guys, even though Akogan is a very good friend of mine.
But you are happy, isn't
it? I'm not.
You are.
I'm not.
You are.
I'm not.
Oh, so those who are petitioning are against it. You see your logic.
I'm not.
You see your logic.
Don't
you see your logic?
Comrade,
those who are petitioning are in support.
Mutala,
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 let him wrap.
Stop being mischievous.
Okay.
Stop being mischievous.
You see your logic.
But what I'm saying is that
you are not.
The action is totally reckless. It is unacceptable. It's illegal. The Supreme Court and all judges in our court need to be protected like any other Ghanaians, because the judges, they don't have any opportunity to defend themselves.
Some of them speak on radio.
Now, my own colleague, I was part of the vetting committee. Look at the story that is coming up. I feel very uncomfortable. But my own colleague, I will sit here and be cascading. Do you understand? And when I'm meeting the chairman, I ask you, did you say this? That they should kidnap the Chief Justice?
Where did
we cannot confirm.
You see,
like that.
So it's the whole thing is a bit murky,
right?
And quite unsavory.
He has very disappointing. To wrap up.
You know,
he has
you
me to wrap up.
Please, you can't come in. You cannot.
Titus, please go on. Please go on.
So, let us allow the Supreme Court judges and all of their colleagues to have their peace. They should continue. They should have the support of the police and the security of the state, including all of us. Why? When they gave President Mama the verdict, were you not happy? He was wearing all white in the presidency.
The verdict was given by the people of Ghana.
You understand?
When the verdict.
Can I speak, young man?
No, but old man, you are referring to me, old man, so I have to respond.
You understand?
Okay.
When the judges gave him the verdict,
they
were happy.
You're wrapping up.
They were jumping, hallelujah, rolling all over the place. And the same lords. I said that what these guys have done is a precedent for all of us. Mm. All of us are social commentators.
Okay.
It doesn't matter the journalists. And again, this is not a way of trying to pin down press freedom. Not at all.
Oh, but that is
people have the opportunity to speak their mind. But you need to be responsible.
Yes,
right.
Not a threat.
You need to be responsible in everything. What is this?
No, you have been talking.
You have been talking more than I do.
He's wrapping up. Please wrap up.
Okay,
I'm saying that, right.
Take minutes and talk.
I've heard the NDC and the apparatchiks, including ministers, including Mutala sitting here, that we are trying to suppress press freedom. That is totally untrue. We are not. We should be responsible in every statement that we make.
Okay.
And for that matter, if you think that what you are going to say will bring problem, keep your mouth shut.
Okay.
Don't go and say things that will land you in problems.
Right.
Do you understand?
Okay.
So Titus, please, people can go ahead and make their statement, whatever, any shape.
Just that, be careful.
Be careful.
Okay.
Right.
No. Okay. What again are you going to say?
No one endorses what they said. What we simply
you
are
endorsing.
Saying,
you are forcing the
please,
president.
Please, please. Oh, please. What
you want the president to release them?
Oh, please. When I was making references to the, when I was making references to portions of the constitution, I was doing it for a purpose.
No one endorses any attack on the judiciary. It's one thing that will protect at any point in time. But what we're simply saying is that people signing the petition are also exercising their democratic and constitutional like rights, and it ought to be respected. Right. By the way, in this country, a gentleman called Red in Tamale shot a gun to disrupt the electoral process. The then youth organizer, my senior brother, someone I respect so much, Mustafa Hamid, held a press conference in Tamale, threatened everybody excluding himself, threatened no, the... I'm no, coming. I'm saying it's a fact. I'm making a... I'm making a factual statement. I'm not guessing.
He threatened everybody and threatened the commander
of the prisons in Tamale.
What are you talking
Lo
about?
Lo and behold, Red was taken out of legal custody and the gentleman was transferred. These people are talking about respect to rule of law. I'm coming. He's talking about the NDC.
Why were you here when the judges gave order?
Okay. Your party was born out of chaos and anarchy and murder.
South Africans,
okay.
What did you do?
Calm down.
Did you kill the judges?
Let me get. Did you not kill judges? Let me get Mr. Kodepoko to
calm down. Did you not kill judges?
Titus, please. Titus, please.
Can I have the floor now?
Allow Mr. Kodepoko to have the floor.
I think that
the president should go inside.
One, that much is given, much is expected. And the journalist that sits on radio, that says a lot. Because you've been given the mic to speak to us, much has been given unto you, so much is expected of you. In a street parlance, they say that bad man don't take back the chat. Meaning that if you're a bad man and you sit on there and say what you want to say, don't take back the chat. Go to jail, do your time, and have your stripes. That's what it is. No, so they should do their time and have the strike. So when they come out, they can call themselves the bad
man. Let me ask you this before we go. You can't distinguish gentlemen.
What is this?
None of you is on the floor, please. No, I'm not asking
you. No. What is this?
Mr. Kujibu, let's
see. Titus,
now, the issue here, Titus is suggesting, and you're also saying that if the president agrees to the petition, it means that he affirms what the Muntie Three have done. Is it not to say that if the president on July 1 decides to free some people based on his constitutional mandate, he affirms what they did and went to jail? Is that as simple as that?
Do you know how the pardon thing is done?
It takes some amount of
The pardon thing, you don't go to jail. And in jail, whilst you're in jail, start beating up people and start and be pardoned. No.
But
there is a process. There's a pardon board. There's a process. When you're in jail, one, you have to have recourse for what you did first.
Right.
You can't be, Atai cannot be in prison, still stealing in prison, sorry to say, and be pardoned.
Even murderers. Okay?
Murderers cannot be killing in prison and be pardoned. You need to. No. My point is that. No, but people do.
No,
people do.
Allow him.
What I'm saying is that we have not had that process of recourse. Okay. The people just got sentenced.
Right.
They've just been settled in. They've not had the recourse. They've not had that. Listen, what you guys should have done.
So even if the president reduces the 4 months to 3.5 months.
What I'm saying is that what they should have done, let the people go. Let the dust settle.
The people are already inside.
Yes, let the dust settle. The minute they were sentenced, the following day, this pardon. No, I would take it if I said, if I do the chat, I will not take it back. But I wouldn't do it. I'm a bad man, so I don't take back the chat. Okay. That's me. My point is that, look, if I would not say what is not right, because I'm well cultured, well educated, so I wouldn't do that.
But don't say that.
I'm not going to go there with you. What I'm saying to you is that, they should have let the dust settle. If we want the president to talk about it, let the people go in, have remorse, let them settle, and then start this thing. But it was too early.
People
the day
are expressing
after.
Their democratic right, and you question that.
So you think that
the judges are not democratic.
Of dealing
I thought we could look at the inmates, energy issue.
Okay, let's energy.
No, we have run out of time.
Let's talk about energy.
Why not? Let's talk about energy.
Let's talk about
energy.
Let's talk about energy. It's my area, so you can now ask me first. It's my area, so ask me first.
Okay, a quick brief on that. I mean, Parliament, the document is before Parliament, and already calls are that Parliament shouldn't agree to this.
Yes. Well, quick one. You see, this thing, the first question I ask is that, who is early power? People should go and find out who early power is. Two, when minister, Honorable Janapo, was talking, he was using we. And my question is that, who is the we? If Parliament have questions on this deal, he should resort it to early power, because this is not a government transaction.
Right.
And you see, I've been saying this on a lot of platforms, that listen, the way government is propagating this, people are asking, government is going to sign a contract, government is going to sign a contract, government is going to procure. And I keep explaining to people that it is not government.
But is it government that is saying
it? No, but you see, the way Honorable Janapo, the Honorable Janapo was on a platform, the way he was defending it, made it seem, defend the deal, that that we are going to do this, we are going to do that. But there's no we. Honorable Janapo is the Minister of State for the country.
Okay.
Early power. Mm. For me, what I'm saying is that the government should have put it out there that it is not the government that is going to procure a 950-something million project. It is early power. All the government is doing, the government is just presenting their PPA in Parliament. So if there's any questions, they should go and ask early power. So the government should not be defending this, because it's not the government.
The
way Honorable Janapo is defending this.
Okay, briefly, Mutala, come in.
The way Mutala is wearing this, Mutala mean this. Don't make conclusions on that. Honestly, the way this is how I see it. And therefore, that should be the conclusion. Minister has a responsibility to explain to the people of this country. Mm-hmm. This is what government is doing. To the extent to which there is a document in Parliament. Now, if they call the minister and the minister says, no, I don't have any comment on it, I'm not going to comment on it because the issue is being done by a private entity, of course, with PPP from government. I mean, I think that would mark nothing but
the responsibility. PPP is not from government, it's
saying,
from ECG.
But ECG is a state institution, and the Minister of Power has the responsibility. Mm. If you have a state institution that is under the jurisdiction of a specific ministry, that ministry has the responsibility to explain to the people of this country. I am paid my salary to do what I am supposed to do. Mm-hmm. If someone asks me, or a journalist calls me, or if you like a group of journalists, we want this information, I says, no, I'm not going to comment on it because I have the information I don't want to give you. That would be absolutely irresponsible. I have a responsibility to communicate to the Ghanaian populace, and you do that through such medium. I can decide, this radio station, I wouldn't comment on, but I have other...
So your point is that government can speak on behalf of this project?
Of course. Okay, it depends on how the language is couched, and I agree with you. Okay. But government has a responsibility to communicate to the people of this country.
Titus, briefly, you have just about 1 minute.
The government keep telling us that they don't have a generation problem. So if you don't have a generation problem, what is the basis for this extra 400 they're talking about?
Okay.
The issue is about the financial angle. The inability of government to support the purchase of light crude to power these thermal plant all over the place.
Mm.
So the point is that they should make funds available to make sure they get the light crude to power all these things. You understand? For me, I see this thing as an avenue for them to do their own thing.
The document is before you members of Parliament. So
we don't need it. What already we have in the system can support it.
How do you
Can support it.
We do.
Okay.
What we have currently can support it. Get us the light crude and power the machine. What is a way of trying to waste money?
Every year.
I am grateful.
We understand.
We have PPAs. We have PPAs up to 14,000 megawatts.
His candidate is 14,000 megawatts.
I'm grateful.
You can't do it because you are not achieving.
Gentlemen, can I wrap up the show nicely?
They cannot create. They are not achieving.
Can I wrap up the show nicely, gentlemen? I am grateful, gentlemen. Please, can you please shut down the microphone? Let's wrap up the show.
All right.
Ibrahim Mutala Mohammed is Deputy Minister for Trade and Industry, and he's a Member of Parliament for Nantong. And then Dadeni Titus Glover is the MP for Tema East. And Kojo Poku is a social commentator and energy expert. Gentlemen, I'm grateful for your time. And this is the Lexi Command Center. We pledge to remain responsible, and I'm sure that it will be more responsible.